Hello and welcome to DDOcast episode 386, recorded live on Sunday, June 14th. I'm your host, Patrick. This week's screenshot, Nanrad visits Vesexplorer in the 226th screenshot of the week. It's a nice little shot of Korthos there. We've got a couple of fun guests this week, fan favorites, I think. And we'll start by introducing Cordovan, a.k.a. Jerry, founder of DDOcast.
Hey, thanks very much for having me on. I'm not the fun one, though.
It's true. The real fun one, no disrespect to the other two guests, we have Lessa from DDO Cocktail Hour and Damsels of DDO.
Hey, Patrick.
Hi, welcome. She's nice enough not to actually introduce other people when she's a guest on their show. Unlike people that will remain nameless.
You mean like I didn't introduce you or thank you at the end of the show for being on it last time? Yeah, that's me.
And we also have Jeff Hanna. Welcome back, sir.
Because somebody has to kill the odd moment that isn't already covered by Lessa and a Turban employee.
So we like to talk about Dungeons & Dragons online.
Bring the journalism. You bring the journalism, Lessa brings the fun, and I don't know what I do.
Hey, it can't all be
I bring hopefully accurate information.
You stand there while we try and pull secret information out of you. We like to talk about Dungeons & Dragons Online nearly every weekend. You can watch us through Twitch, YouTube, the DDO forums, or our website at DDOcast.com. DDOcast is hosted by Cyber Ears, the awesome podcast hosting network. Shows are usually available within a few days of recording. The next show will probably be next Saturday, and you can stay updated by following us on our social media pages or our website, DDOcast.com, with our calendar. I need to get back on top of for a short time, I was really on top of the shows, and like while I was recording this show, I would have next week's already planned out. I'd have the guests all in. Yeah, that all kind of flew out the window. I had a bunch of stuff going on and behind, and between Guild Feud and the next thing, I've been putting a little extra time into those and not planning my shows. But for this show, we have some more Warlock updates, and we're going to be talking more extensively about challenges. Some tips and tricks for them, what they are, why you should run them, and all that stuff. And I think we'll start off challenges by handing Lessa a soapbox and ask Lessa, why should we run challenges? what are challenges? And you have such nice notes that you added. So
I have a lot to say when you hit one of my I don't want to say happy buttons. You hit one of my hot buttons or whatever whenever you said, hey, do you want to talk about challenges? Because this is one of my all-time favorite things
You weren't aware of it, but Samus and I were talking off the air on the show about your happy buttons.
And it wasn't part of this discussion because
where would be the
you're still that? You're still not the age of consent in the state that you live in. Okay, got it. Well, see, what is a challenge? You tell me, and then I'll tell you why you should do it.
Well, challenges are, they are slightly different than quests. They have more concrete and, they can have concrete objectives, but they tend to be also at the same time kind of fluid. You're getting a score, you're trying to achieve some sort of goal. There's optional objectives as well. There's five different kind of objectives. One you have to do to win and get anything out of the quest. And the other ones just give you extra XP and points. Really, you get a piece of favor for each star. They're not high favor quests or endeavors. However, you can get, in some of them, quite a large chunk of experience. And that's based on stars. And then you get materials that you can craft stuff that are based on your score. And what that is. And there were leaderboards for a while, and I'm pretty sure those went away with my DDO. Jerry, you offered to kind of give a background in some of this stuff. You want to tell us a little bit about how challenges came out and
I guess I can provide a little bit of a historic perspective as to what they are. So, you know, challenges first came around with the House Caineth content. So that would be around, if I recall correctly, sort of first half of 2011. And at the time, one of the things that we were looking to do as a development team is to try to find a way to release a lot more content in a shorter amount of time. You know, we are well known for our sort of handcrafted dungeons, and DDO players know that when we mean handcrafted, we mean yes, handcrafted, as in, yes, it takes a lot of work to do this stuff. A lot of man hours, frankly, to get these dungeons out the door. And so one of the advantages of the technology that we use for challenges is that it allowed us to create content that would be usable across a wide level range, say level 10 to 25, or I think at the time, yeah, it was about 10 to 25, I think, when it first came out, maybe something like that, like, give or take.
Yeah, it was. The level cap was still 20 at the time.
Yeah, yeah, but I think the challenges even then went up to 25.
Yeah, yeah, House C went up to 25.
Yep. Yeah. So that was really that was one of the big reasons why we sort of brought in the challenge tech, is to allow us to, at the time, the thought was, well, we can make our dungeons and we can sort of have them scale throughout multiple levels. And also, frankly, for Crystal Cove. There would be no Crystal Cove if it wasn't for the challenge technology. And so in some ways, Crystal Cove was the proving ground for the challenge technology. The Crystal Cove, for those who don't know, is an event that we do, a pirate-themed event where you go into sort of a piratey area, collect stuff, and then do the kobold mining challenge. And so we developed it for Crystal Cove to sort of learn how to do the technology. You know, the coders can learn how to, all the ins and outs of it. And then we created the House Caineth stuff. And then later on, with Menace of the Underdark, we came out with a bunch of Forgotten Realms challenges. But one of the core, like I say, the core technological difference between challenges and, quote, regular quests is that challenges scale in difficulty by level. And there are certain trade-offs, frankly, that you have to do as a result of that. You can't quite handcraft every level range because you'd be making 25 quests, essentially, right? So we're close to it. So that was the idea, is that it was going to be a, quote, cheaper, easier way to make a whole lot more content a lot faster. And unfortunately, as the reality of the world goes, after we made some challenges, we realized, well, the whole takes less time thing isn't exactly true. It ended up actually, frankly, being more work rather than less when all was said and done. So that is why we have not released challenges, frankly, since Menace of the Underdark, as we've opted, given our available resources, to focus on more of the handcrafted content. But there is a place for it, too, because one of the other big things you wanted to do with challenges in sort of the planning stage was to be that short content. You know, we have wilderness areas for those who just want to kill stuff for 20 minutes during lunch at work. But we also wanted challenges to kind of be like that, as another thing you could do when you only had 15, 20 minutes, regardless of the size of the group, regardless of makeup of the party, whatever. You know, you could basically just go in and kill some time and get some XP and all the rest. So those were really, I guess, two or three of the big reasons why challenges came about. And it is different technology than sort of the regular questing. So it's not like you can just sort of add challenge tech to, say, Cry for Help, and then all of a sudden be able to run it at any level. It's far more complex than that. I don't know how to describe it. I would have to leave it up to someone more technically knowledgeable than me. But that's sort of the historic precedent of challenges, is it's actual technology that we brought into our core engine and then retrofitted to be able to provide these challenges. So when all is said and done, though, it's popular content. You know, some people really like challenges. Clearly, we're talking about it now, even though we haven't had any new challenges for a couple of years. But I don't know that it's something we plan to do a lot more of in the future. I think if we did use the technology again, it would probably be more in the realm of event scaling, because it's been very successful, frankly, at that, more than, say, trying to create a new challenge dungeon. But you never know. If someone has an idea for it and really, you know, has the floon, as Severlin would say, for it, then we'll do it. So
I like that word.
Wow. Floon. That was such a thorough answer. It's the whole topic is dead.
Sorry.
We're done.
Watch it.
Well, that's the history, right?
Oh, no.
Just to do it justice, too, I believe the Cove was initially released at a convention, right? It was at PAX East, I think. It was kind of a trial thing.
Yes,
fun fact, the first time I ever tried the Cove was during my tour at Turbine.
Yeah, right. That's right. You actually did. That was, did. Really that, was at the time that you got in there, and we
had
not even done it
from moment one.
Yeah, yeah. I don't think it was actually made for PAX, but I think it was made around the same time. So while we were making Crystal Cove, we were like, well, can we make a tiny version of it for the convention that was coming up?
Right.
I think that that's sort of how
it wasn't
that
made
worked.
Specifically yeah. for it, but it was kind of unveiled yeah. during that. And there was a contest, and people yeah. would come and run the scores. And I think the high scorer got like a free lifetime VIP or something like that.
Yep, that's right. So we had a free VIP every day in that. So
yeah, it was a fun little thing. I think it actually makes a lot of sense for a convention too. You know, here's a free trial. Check out the game and the engine and.
Right.
And have a little fun with this thing. So,
you know, especially at a large convention where you've got to get perhaps even literally 1,000 people through your machines every day. You know, you need to have something where they can feel, because you're not going to learn an MMO for a 3-minute demo, right? So it's got to be something where you can literally just sit down, hit WASD, and figure it out. And only play for a couple of minutes so that we can get the next group in. And so the thing like a challenge technology, a little contest like that works really, really well for these kind of events.
Indeed. All right. I think now we'll give Lessa back her soapbox.
Oh, thank you. Okay, so big quick overview and then I'm going to dig into this. Challenges are versatile. Like Jerry said, you can run it at whatever your level is, you get loot while you're doing it, and it's surprise loot. It's surprise loot in a little box that you can open up later. Or you can do what I like to do, and I like to collect all the chests and then open them up at the end of the day because it's like Christmas. You also get a little bit of XP, and the most important thing to me, you get favor that you can use to get really cool stuff from the House Caineth favor guy, i.e. you can get crafting XP pots, and correct me there if I'm wrong, but I'm positive you can buy crafting XP pots from that guy, and you get these masterful craftsmanship, they're not shards, but you can turn them into masterful craftsmanship shards. Very, very cool whenever you're crafting. It's a lot easier if you can make whatever you're making a little bit lower level so you can use it sooner. So, I'm going to ask you, why should... Go ahead.
On that note, I wanted to mention too that... if you want to unlock the Artificer without having to purchase it, you have to get the favor in House C, which does require challenges. You can get the favor mark that you're talking about where you can access their little crafter NPC. You can do that just by running the quest, because I think you can do it by only running the quest. But if you want to unlock Artificer, you have to do challenges. You only have to average like 2 stars across all of the challenges, the epic and heroic ones. So you don't have to get a lot of stars, but you do have to run challenges if you want to unlock Artificer. Please continue.
Or you could just spend your turbine points unlocking Artificer like I did. Merry Christmas! Yes! Instant gratification. All right. So why should you even bother? Okay, go ahead, Jeff.
I have to say that Patrick's encyclopedic knowledge is sometimes very impressive for a 12-year-old. I don't know how he does.
He's 14. We discussed this already. He's the age of consent in some states. All right. So why should you even bother with challenge gear? Well, here are my reasons, and you guys feel free to add your own. And it's because I don't do a lot of raiding. I don't have time. I don't have the awesome social skills, I guess, to join a raid and be as cool as you guys, but I still want to round out my build with usable, meaningful gear. And this is not something that, oh, hey, if I do this quest, it might drop for me. This is a guarantee at the end of a road that I know that I'm going to earn by collecting these, by doing these challenges and collecting these challenge ingredients. There are pages, there's like something like, I looked today, there are something like 15 pages of gear. And you can get this at every level as you go up in level. Also, because unlike rare loot drops out in explorer areas like, let's say, Firestorm Greaves that drops out in the Mediterranean Desert, for example, you could spend your whole DDO career trying to get those boots and never see them. I've seen them once in 8 years. Challenge gear is going to come to you. You don't have to worry about it. Because once you purchase an item from a vendor, you can upgrade that item as you level up. The item levels up with you and it gets better. More stuff gets added to it. Because challenges are perfectly soloable, And it's a great way to rack up XP and useful ingredients that I'll talk about in a little bit. I'm going to go over just a couple of more advantages and then ask you guys why you do challenges. You can use these excess ingredients to buy things from these challenge vendors. You can buy Slayer potions that gives you an extra, I think, 10% whenever you go out to run Slayer areas. You can buy minor XP potions that gives you an extra 5% XP, and that stacks with your Voice of the Master. So now, for free, you haven't done anything, and you're getting earning an extra 10% XP for just for doing what you do. You can also buy regular, pretty much whatever potion. I don't recommend that you do that, because I like to use my ingredients for other things, but basically cure pots, jump pots, protection, resistance, etc., etc. You can also use these. This is the coolest thing, and this is something that's kind of a personal goal of mine. You can use your excess epic challenge ingredients to buy tokens of the 12. You take those tokens over to Lar, who is like a earth elemental, and he stands behind the Tower of the 12. Is he a magma?
He looks like
a
magma.
Yeah, he has some fire on him. Yeah. Well, you go talk to him, and he will trade those tokens in for augments that you can't otherwise buy in places like the Giant Hold. I mean, we're talking adamantine arms, we're talking silvered strikes, death block. If you don't, let's say you're shard poor, you don't have the shards to go and buy yourself a featherfall or water breathing or whatever, you can buy it from Lar. So this is a way to get cheap stuff. This is a way to get good stuff for cheap, is what I'm trying to say. Because I like to spend my points on paint for my ship. I don't know about you guys, but I like getting this free stuff. Go ahead, Jerry.
I was saying, that's a really good point. I had actually forgotten about the tokens of the 12 from there, but that is actually a nice little tip.
How could you forget about that? That was like one of the major things coming behind the we're going to stop giving. There was a point in which Turbine was going to take the true hearts out of that mechanism. And people were like, no, please no. And it was kind of one of the main concerns is because...
Get that from Lahar, but I didn't know that you could... I forgot that you could get it trading your challenge ingredients for
it. So. That's where you can generally get more tokens faster by running the sea challenges. By the way, I think the list that Leslie gave of loot is mostly house sea challenges, not the evening star challenges.
That's where my main focus is.
Yeah, I would say too. I personally, in terms of augments, I generally save my tokens to the 12 for True Hearts of Wood, and will buy the augments out of the store on the grounds that it's the same number of tokens for an augment and a heart of true wood, but a true heart normally costs like 1,500 turbine points, and the tokens cost maybe, or the augments cost maybe 200 turbine points, but they're the same number of tokens of the 12, so that's kind of my approach.
Just run twice as many challenges. There you go. Just run twice as many challenges. Buy both. ¿Por qué no los dos?
Be an option. I also wanted to point out that you can get guild renown potions out of those as well. And I believe all of those potion, the XP and the Slayer potions and the guild potions are all bound to character. So be aware of that when you turn in and get 20 guild renown potions on your same character. Oops.
Yep. You know, I don't know if we really quite explained what challenges are, though. Have we? I mean, I know that a lot of people know, but
well,
someone
else through the different
players kind of going, what?
I don't know. I thought you covered it pretty thoroughly in the first hour of the EDOcast.
Okay. Yeah. No, anyway, yeah, they're a little more arcadey to some way, and they are points-based. You get a score at the end, which you don't typically do for regular questing, and that score ultimately determines how many rewards you get. The only other thing I guess I'd mention kind of about the nuts and bolts of challenges is that you can buy challenges from the DDO store like you would buy an adventure pack, but there are other ways you can run challenges too. In both Evening Star and in House Caineth, there are challenge token vendors. And depending on your account status, you can get between, if I recall correctly, 1 and 3 a day. I think it's 1 for free, 2 for premium, 3 for VIP, something like that. And then you'll turn in those challenges almost like a quarter in an arcade machine. And you'll be able to run challenges several times per day for free. So if you're perhaps a more price-conscious DDO player, it can be a great way to get ingredients, all these potions, slayer pots, what have you, raid-style items, you know, all sorts of good stuff, and you don't even have to pay for it. So that's not a bad deal.
You can also buy those tokens in the store, which are significantly less than the cost of the pack, which I don't necessarily recommend. However, I mention it because a few months back there was a freebie that was 5 of those tokens. So there's also that.
Yeah.
I collect those tokens even though I'm a VIP because in the challenges themselves, you can change them in for power-ups. So
that too, yeah.
Kind of handy to suddenly be quad damage and 8 times speed.
Yep, that's a good point. So what I want to do, and we'll talk about, so that's kind of an overview coming into why you want to run challenges. And we're going to talk about the different challenges. We're not going to talk about everyone specifically, but we're going to go kind of map by map and just kind of throw out some tips and kind of give a quick overview of them. And then we've got some stuff on the back end that we'll give Lessa back the soapbox and let her talk some more. But so we'll start with the ones in House C. And we'll also probably maybe mention some pieces of loot at the end as well. We're going to start with the Lava Caves, which is, if you've done Crystal Cove, you'll be very familiar with it. You're guiding kobolds to collect crystals. The first two are actually that way. But the Lava Caves is kind of interesting because you can drop teleporters in certain circles of light, and they become a two-way teleportation as opposed to their normal one-way teleportation. So it can be kind of a fun little mechanism. Do you guys have any tips you want to share for this one before I share mine?
I'd rather leave others for the tips. I mean, I guess I would say pretty much a lot of the same tips for Crystal Cove work for the Lava Caves, but there are some exceptions.
There are really big crystals. I don't know if that's in all of them or if it's just the one. I think it may just be the one, the Colossal Crystal.
Yeah, that's the one I don't like, the Colossal Crystal that gives you Jade Scorpions. I have a note about that later as well. But what's cool about the Lava Cave, well, really what's cool about all the different challenges in the Lava Caves is that you can go back and forth, like you said. Once you find a circle, you put a teleporter on it, you don't have to run all the way back to the Foreman. You can just teleport yourself back to the Foreman using the same teleporter that the kobolds used.
Yeah, that's
very
cool.
It's a nice way to manage your aggro. Yeah.
It is worth noting, though, that monsters can also use the teleporters, which can be troublesome sometimes.
Right.
Got to be aware of that. It's important.
It's like an elevator, right? Anybody can get in it.
Something like that. My general mode.
But at its core. No, go ahead.
General tactic with this one is to go towards the right as you come in. And usually there's a good starting point there where I figure out where else I want to go, which usually means going to the bridge straight ahead and looking down to the left and all the way down. D-Door is really handy in here if you're running the torches. It doesn't take, if you're not doing Colossal Crystal, you know, you can generally just have everyone else kind of park at the beginning and have one, maybe two people kind of go out to the where you're collecting crystals. It is sometimes a little tricky. The kobolds do not go, quote, backwards very well, by which I mean if you find a teleporter and they come out through the two-way teleporter and then go up, they go closer to the entrance or to the starting point and collect crystals, they'll actually won't go back to the teleporter. They'll just take the long way, generally getting themselves killed. So that's kind of something to be aware of in here.
That's why you got to purchase a second teleporter and put it in front of them.
Oftentimes,
kobolds only see what's in front of them. Kobold doesn't care. It's like the honey badger. Kobold don't care.
I think technically, the way that tech works on that is I believe the kobolds are largely set, with some exceptions, to go to the most recently placed pathing. So if that's closest to them, as determined by their AI. So there may be times where, let's say, you've got a teleporter behind you and some torches that you laid afterwards in front of you. They might opt to go to the torches in front of you if they deem it to be faster. I think that's how it works.
You just kind of got to be aware of what
my favorite. Yeah, my favorite lava cave is the time is money, because it's over in 5 minutes. So you can get all of the XP and all of the ingredients and everything that you can in any other challenge in 5 minutes. Yay! That's a big plus. I also have a walkthrough on how you can solo that if you're interested over at DDO Gamer, including a video.
That's a good one. Also, just a quick tip. If you are doing Colossal Scorpion, their Colossal Crystal, which I actually kind of like, just be aware that when they pick up that big crystal, you're going to get a lot of fun stuff in the area. So be ready for that. Although I think that one's kind of convenient because I think that's the one where you have to resurrect kobolds for a star. There's also one where you have to send kobolds through a teleporter for a star. If you remove the torches from both ends and just leave the two teleporters, they'll cycle through pretty quick, which is another trick in that one.
Just to be a little instructional here, if you are in a challenge and you hit the X key, you know, I'll bring up the quest thing, and in that it'll tell you specifically what you need to do for each of the stars, the objectives. Each one of those is going to be a star. So if you're sitting there going, what do I need to do? Let's just go take a look at the bottom of that report, and it'll tell you exactly what you need to do to earn the stars.
The wiki has all that, too, very helpfully laid out.
Yeah, that's because I put it there.
Yay.
So let's talk about the Extraplanar Palace, which is also in Hell's Seat, and it's very similar, but a much smaller map. Functionally, it's more or less the same, except there's no circles to stick the teleporters in. It's more like the Cove, but again, a small, condensed map. There's also no rest shrine. Be aware of that. Although they tend to be a little shorter, although the Dragon's Horde is like 20 minutes, which I think is one of the longest timed ones. So be ready for the long haul on that one. But you have time to collect a lot of ingredients with that one as well. My kind of personal mode with this one is to go up and to the right as you zone in first. I clear that kind of area because it's the most self-contained area. So if you run through and clear the whole thing, your kobolds will be generally really safe to run in that direction, as opposed to some of the other areas where they can kind of get lost and take a different route and find other stuff and fun things like that. I don't know if anyone else has any tips on this one.
That one, it's really easy to look right and left and north. So I do that, especially if I'm soloing, because I'm not going to be in enough places to be able to defend a long line and explore. So it only takes an extra 10 seconds to look right and look left. If there's no purples either way, I know I'm going up north. It's seconds.
Oh, actually, I've got a good tip. And this applies to Crystal Cove as well, but I don't know how many people know that you can cast buffs on the kobolds, like haste, and they'll get there faster. So there's a lot of things you can cast on those kobolds to really make your life a lot easier and get those stars better.
They also take detours.
Yeah.
That's good to know.
Yeah.
I would say definitely to kind of echo what Jeff was saying. Other than Dragon's Horde, which you've got so much time, you can go in every direction. You know, I don't even in Dragon's Horde, I don't go deep into anything other than the upper right corner. I generally will do a quick little jaunt out with a couple of torches, get the closer stuff, and then start a new one rather than going deeper into the various directions you can go. So I don't get very far out to them, even in Dragon's Horde. In Dragon's Horde, I don't really... the way I approach Dragon's Horde, because it's so long and one of the starts is to kill monsters, I will send like certain members of the party go one direction and just clear the whole side. And if you find the dragon, have fun. There's a room at the end of each of the... east, west, and north, I think, are the different directions you can go. One of them's going to have the dragon every time, which is always a star. But generally, if it's Dragon's Horde, I know I'm going to hit kind of the up right, up left, lower right, lower left, and then straight path. I know I'm going to hit all those, so I just kind of have a sequence that I hit them all in. But if you're doing one of the shorter ones, I pretty much just go up to the right and then figure out which of the other paths I'm going to go to first. And when I decide that's clear, I'll go to the next one. Rather than going deeper into the dungeon, I stay pretty close to the center on that.
I completely agree with you. I use your strategy, Patrick. I can't be everywhere at once. So I only plan on going east and west. And I get whatever I get. I did discover whenever I was running challenges last night that in the Extraplanar Palace that when I hit my M key, it's marked on my map where the dragon is. So if I want to go get him, I can go get him.
Yeah, if you have
it's
kind
of nice if you have
it.
Someone else with you, yeah, that one of you can go be on dragon duty or mob killing duty or moat duty or whatever, and the other one can concentrate on picking up crystals, which is very nice. Good teamwork.
Yeah, usually for lava caves and Extraplanar Palace, particularly if you're going for stars, one person is going to be primarily responsible for the torches, although I will say that if you can get really good at running torches and can instruct people, hey, cut off the line, send it this way, or I did this more in Crystal Cove than either of these ones, but you can kind of prep the line if you have extra torch, the next line you're going to go with extra torches, and then just have someone connect the dots and then leave the rest of the torches on the ground. It can be a really good way to do it, but you know, you can enlist other people to help, but definitely one person's going to be primarily responsible for the torches, and the other people are going to be responsible for maybe holding the center, because both in Lava Caves and Extraplanar Palace, mobs tend to go towards the center, or they tend to be set in specific places, which the torcher can clear those ones. The other one, they also kind of help get the other stars. In Extraplanar Palace, your tip about finding the dragon's a really good one. If you're trying to find the moats, you can envis yourself and run through the dungeon. Mostly stuff won't harass you when you do that, so you can find those all pretty quick.
And even if it does harass you, eventually it's going to rubber band back to its own spot.
Right.
So that's kind of nice.
If something is set in these dungeons, and this is generally true anywhere, if they have a specific set point where they spawn, they will leash. If they don't, they'll follow you the whole time. And a lot of these, it's not actually so much about killing things as it is about keeping other things safe, like your kobolds in this instance.
It depends on what you're in for, right? Because the XP is based on your star total, but your ingredients are based on your points total.
Correct.
So if you chose to, one possible tactic would be to basically ignore all the objectives and just during whatever time you have available, you just kill as much stuff as you can just to sort of get ingredients.
Lava Caves and Extraplanar Palace, generally speaking, the stars are pretty easy. If you have a party, you can send one or two people to kind of achieve certain stars, even if your main goal is to collect ingredients. The one thing about Extraplanar Palace that is probably the trickiest thing is the star that's Get the Foreman Killed. Does anyone have any particular favorite strategies for that?
It's really hard not to save the Foreman, isn't it? Especially if you're right there, and the best way is to let a mob chase him off. And for some reason, every once in a while, you'll catch him running off into the acid that surrounds the platform in the center in the Extraplanar Palace. Just let him hang out there, and eventually he'll die. It's terrible, but it's true. Or you can let Devastasia kill him, the demon queen that comes out. What do you call her?
Good. Yeah.
Yeah, the Marilith, the snake lady. Yeah, you can, but you have to be careful about her because she'll kill your kobolds at the same time. So.
The hag is another good one for getting the foreman killed. Although again, you have to watch out for killing the rest of your group of kobolds. I have at certain point, if I were actually running it for stars, what I'll do is I will kind of herd the kobolds into an area that has already been cleared, so they're not going to pick up crystals and go back, and they're just going to kind of run between the torches and cut off the beginning so they can't get back to the foreman, and then bring something there to kill them. It's a little tricky to pull off, but I have done it successfully once or twice. But yeah, it's kind of a trick to get him killed and not get the guy with four barrels killed at the same time.
Yeah, whoever came up with that as a required objective for six stars is that's just an evil person. That's all I
can. It was pretty mean, wasn't it? While you're talking about the extraplanar palace, Patrick, I wanted to mention that in all these challenges, every once in a while you pick up these little squares with kobold heads on them, and they just... They either come out of the chest or they randomly appear in my inventory. I don't know. But I started finding them last night, and I said, oh, I'm in the extraplanar palace. I'm going to use these kobold buffs. So I started clicking on them, and one of them turned me into a kobold, and I was carrying five... I was loaded with five barrels. I was carrying crystals, and I was with Saba Jade at the time, and she looked at me, and she said, what are you doing? Go turn those in! So I tried, and you can't. So there's that. But it's a nice little disguise if you're trying to draw aggro away from your kobolds. I think that would be super useful in the Colossal Crystal and Lava Caves.
Yeah, you can also...
If you're trying to draw aggro away from your progenitor guy.
With the guy who grabs a progenitor crystal, you can throw him an invisibility after he grabs the crystal. You can invis the kobolds, but when they pick up a crystal, they lose the invisibility. You can also blur them and stuff like that, too, so... I'll say Lava Caves, fire resistance is a good choice. The tier 1 out of Divine Crusader that gives them all resists, that's a good one here. You can also revive kobolds if you still have the foreman, by the way. And one of the objectives, and at least one of them, is revive 12 kobolds, which cost one crystal more every single time you do it. But it's fun to get the kobolds killed, too. All right, let's talk about the mansion, Rushmore's Mansion, which is not a kobold quest or a kobold challenge. It's very different. This one, you are looking for bosses to kill. There are five bosses. For all the challenges in this one, killing one of the stars or one of the bosses is a star. Killing all of them is another star, and I believe opening every door is always a star as well. As you kill stuff, you get crests that will unlock doors. As you get farther and farther into the dungeon, you need more and more crests to open a door, and inevitably you'll be asking your party members, do you have a scorpion? Who's got a scorpion? We need a scorpion!
My tip for that, for this one, for this particular map, Patrick, and this was, whenever I first started running challenges, this was my least favorite, because it's kind of, it's bigger and it's more, a little bit more confusing, but the great thing about all these challenges is that there are only four maps, and once you're comfortable with the maps, the only thing that changes is the objectives. So my biggest tip for the mansion is that I take one of my hotbars that I'm not using and I fill it up with all the crests as I get them, and whenever I'm doing these kinds of challenges, I pop that bar out onto my screen so that I can see what I've got, because nothing is more irritating than walking up to a door and not having what you need.
A lot of them have stuff around. You can find crests on the ground. You get them by killing mobs. Generally speaking, the caster mobs seem to give them out more regularly, but there are spots or specific spots that they will potentially be crests, and when you kind of learn those spots, you can check. You can also backspace the crests from far away, so you can kind of get an idea where they are as well. I kind of like it. It's definitely the biggest map out of all of them. I would say, kind of as tips, look for secret doors. There's a secret passage that connects the bathroom with the banner hall. If you are in the banner hall, look up. It's Mario, but you can get up there and get some crests as well. The other thing I'd say, personally, my kind of trick in pathing here is I always go straight for the assassin, which is pretty much always to the right. I think that's correct. I would also say look at the beginning for crests. There's a bunch of rooms at the beginning before you hit any doors. You can get a lot of crests out of to start with. But I always go towards assassin. The assassin never moves. He's always in the same spot. There is one of the variations where the bosses go to random locations, which you can use the same trick for the dragon. You can pop your map open. You can see where they are on the map if you aren't near them. If you have the map, if the map is visible for you, the other ones they always spawn in the same place. Same places, but the assassin doesn't move in that one, and you only have to kill one boss to win and get ingredients, so you can always go to him and kill him. And it's only four doors to get to them, too. So it's pretty easy to get to that one, generally speaking, except when they put a whole bunch of the same crest in your path. I've had that happen. I literally got down to that door, the assassin door once, and it was three of them were the same, and the one before was three of that same one, so I was completely out at that point. You can get skeleton keys in the same manner you can get the kobold buffs, and the one that they move around, moving targets, you have to kill one of the bosses in a bathroom. They do not have to spawn in the bathroom. You can pull them there, FYI.
I have a tip for Rushmore's Mansion. Try to avoid. And you actually can, okay? For some reason, I find it just inexplicably difficult to ever get all the stars on Rushmore's Mansion. I don't think I've ever done it. I also, for some reason, don't find it all that fun. And, I mean, nobody's going to like everything, right? That's going to happen. So I don't do it. Now, but you don't have to, because even if you're trying to build something that requires Rushmore ingredients, there's a trade mechanism. Every ingredient that you're trying to collect, if you collect twice as much of whatever its trade is, you don't have to go into Rushmore's Mansion at all, which makes me very happy. And that's my whole tip.
That's so funny, because I'm the polar opposite of you. I dislike the Colossal Crystal. I can't stand going in there. So I do enjoy Dr. Rushmore's Mansion. So that's the one I always collect twice as much of, because you can trade illuminated manuscripts for jade scorpions. 2-to-1. So I always collect twice as much of that, and then I go and trade them in so I don't have to do the Colossal Crystal. That's awesome. That's awesome that we're so different.
So you actually like Rushmore's?
Yes. Because it's amazing.
Are you in any other ways that I'm not aware of?
Well, it's great because everyone has a job. There's always something to do. And whenever, for example, in moving targets, you think you have a plan in your mind and you think that you're going to a certain place, and then one of the bosses announces, oh, I'm going to go to the bathroom, or oh, I'm going to go break up a fight in the courtyard. So now you've got to change your entire strategy and you've got to think, okay, what am I closer to? Who should I go kill first? I love it. I love it for all the reasons I think that you don't love it.
I just like the idea that one of the objectives is to kill something in a bathroom.
Absolutely.
See, that's part of the turnoff for me. You're explaining how excited you are because you're hoping the quest is going to tell you to go to the bathroom, and it's like, wait a minute, this is heroic fantasy.
But you guys just planned the assassination of the poor foreman and extra planar and the extra planar fellas.
I guess about the only tip I have for Rushmore's Mansion, and this is a personal tip for me, is I like to save those buffs for Rushmore's. So if I have an extra skeleton key, particularly a skeleton key, but also the extra minute of time, that kind of thing, I find Rushmore's Mansion to be particularly useful to have those things around. So if you've got some, might be a good place to use it.
Yeah, Rushmore's Mansion is typically probably the longest out of all the challenges, because every time you open a door, you get extra time. Which can be good if you're going for all of the stars, and you have to need a little time to find all the crests and do that kind of stuff. If you are going for all the doors, you might want to familiarize yourself with the map a few times beforehand to know which side of the door you have to open. That's important. Also, if you're at the back door, just make sure you have all of the crests before you try and start slotting in crests, because there's lots of traps there. And if you start, as soon as you put in one crest, you get a bunch of traps. And if you don't have all of the crests, you're kind of hosed. You have to run back through all the traps, and that's kind of a trick, at least on that end. I would say, though, it's the minute of time is definitely a nice one, because you might be really close to getting another door open, but you need just that little extra time, but you've already invested about 30 minutes in, and if you're really trying to six start, you might end up falling just a little bit short, which is kind of a bummer. So it's a very good place for the minute of time.
Yeah. Very useful.
There is one thing about Rushmore's that I like, and it's that one hallway that has every trap in it. It's got spinners, it's got
such
spikes.
A great trap.
Something spitting fireballs and axes. I've tried so many times to get a good screenshot of it, and I just can't do it justice. But every trap is right there, and I love that.
Yeah,
I'm pretty sure you can thank Flimsy Firewatch for that one. Yeah, I'm pretty sure that's Flimsy's work.
It's a fun little spot.
Yeah.
The front side of that is actually it looks really intimidating, but it's actually not too hard to run through it, even without evasion. The other side, the far side where the back door is not as easy to get through, and those spinner traps are a little bit more effective. All right, so now that we've talked about other people's least favorite ones, we're going to talk about my least favorite one, which is Kobold Island.
What? Go ahead.
It's my least favorite. I am competent at it. Others are much more competent at it than I am. And the way this works is you have to activate extractors, and they mine crystals. So basically, you're protecting different points, different machines that give you more ingredients over time. They have different rates of production. The one thing I'd say about this is killing is less important than aggro management. As long as they're not trying to actively kill your extractors, you're probably going to be okay. You know, you can trail a bunch of mobs all day long. It's a little tricky, but my general mode for this, if I'm just farming ingredients, I had to adapt this for the Makar's challenge a couple weeks back, was this. And I was woefully inadequate at this. But my general strategy is to get up to a large extractor, activate that, and protect it, and kind of slog through these ones. I don't really enjoy Kobold Island as much as I do the other ones. Not say that I don't like it. It's just definitely my least favorite. Lessa apparently really likes this one. Lessa, do you have some good tips here?
I love Kobold Island. I absolutely love it. Unless you're talking about the one that gives you Orthon metal scrap parts. I don't like that one quite as much because you don't have as much time, and because whenever you jump into a portal, you don't know where you're going to come out, and that can be very aggravating, especially if it spits you back out in the exact same spot that you just went in. That's not fun.
I think that one actually is mathematically impossible to six-star. I think people did the math on what it takes to get all the shards for it. But
I barely make it every time, and sometimes I fail. That one, because you just run out of time. You just can't do everything, especially if you're trying to solo the thing. But my absolute favorite, probably of all the challenges, is Kobold Island Kobold Chaos, because you can go in there when you're level 4 or 5, and solo it, and I can come out with anywhere between 600 to 1,000. Ingredients just for one run. It's great. I plan on having 2 small extractors on that island that I'm going to upgrade to the highest, that I'm going to upgrade to get more part, to more to start farming more shards or whatever. And then I always plan on killing the Archon if I can, because you get an extra 150 shards for that. And then that helps you fire up your large extractor. And once you fire up the large extractor, you don't have to go anywhere. As long as you have 6 minutes left in that challenge, you need to fire up that large extractor and upgrade it to the highest level. You need to turn it purple. And that's it. That's all you have to do. Because everybody's going to come to you after that. They don't care about those small extractors. I've had small extractors that never went down because everybody was just so focused on trying to get me off the large extractor. And that's a solo. I tried to video it, but I just didn't think it was. I didn't think I did a great job of explaining everything, so I was like, trash this. But I'd like to do an instructional video of that one. Actually, it's probably my favorite challenge. If you guys have anything that you do, I'd love to hear it. Love to incorporate it.
I would agree, just personally, that's also one of my favorites. My best tip. Well, I got a couple, I guess. Charming is very, very useful in there, because you can charm, put a symbol of persuasion, what have you, on a group of mobs, and you're going to have a lot of, because you're right, aggro management is important. The other thing is I generally think you're spot on with the small than large extractors and all that sort of thing. I will say that if you're a hireling type player, it's okay if hirelings die. There's no death penalty, you know, on challenges, so pick up some hirelings and set them to guard extractors, just kind of so that while you're on the other side of the map protecting one, you don't have to worry so much about the one on the other side. I mean, you will, but they can kind of keep them busy for a while until you can get there. So hirelings can be very, very useful in there. Yeah, those, I mean, those
cannons.
Are
cannons. You can buy cannons from the extractors.
Yes,
set those up as well. I would say that more so. So one of the mechanisms we didn't really talk about is if you have more people in your party, there's two forms of scaling in challenges generally. One is you get more monsters. The other is the monsters are tougher to kill. Kobold Island is probably the one that is best done solo. Not to say that you can't bring friends and hirelings into it, but of all of the challenges, if you're going to run one solo, this is the one that's probably going to be the most economical to do so. It doesn't take a whole lot of effort to necessarily kind of get things going. And like Leslie said, once you get to the large extractor, it's kind of clear sailing from there. But if you have a lot of people in your party in this one, you get a lot of mobs, and it's actually harder to guard the extractors. With the small caveat that you can have people kind of camp out at certain extractors, which is something to kind of be aware of. The other thing I would say, if you're going to run this, find out their return on investment rates, because it takes a large chunk of crystals to power these things up, and like the larges, you pretty much need at least 2 minutes per upgrade to get your money back if you do upgrade them. So just kind of be aware of that.
Yeah, that's why I say my magic number is 6 minutes. If I have 6 minutes left, I know I can fire up a large extractor, and I'm going to get 2,000 shards out of that run.
Yep. Well, I was just going to say, you know, about hirelings, though, you can, you know, buy a bunch of, you know, plat hirelings, and then remember that, unlike, you know, a quest, you have to be at the front of the entrance. You can only have one hireling out at a time. But theoretically, you could, say, get a bunch of hirelings. One of them dies. You dismiss it. You're back on the other side of the map there, you know, to where the, quote, entrance point is. You create another one and do that. So you can always have backup, even if you're treating it a little bit like cannon fodder. The other thing is, again, Dimension Door can be very, very useful in there because it'll bring you back to the, quote, start of the quest, which is sort of kind of ish in the middle. So if you need to cross the map really quickly, Dimension Door can be very useful. It'll get you over there. The other thing, I guess, the map is important to look at because it'll tell you which extractor is being attacked. If it's red, it's being attacked. Mm-hmm. So, yeah. So that if you're sitting there going, I don't know which one's being attacked, just hit M, figure it out, and then get over there. So.
It seems that I'm playing my challenges in Bizarro Challenge World because, once again, I'm directly opposite. I think this one is hard to solo and is way more fun with a group. I love bringing a whole party in there and trying to figure out the timing and stuff. I know there's one specific quest that cannot be completed, and I don't think it's the Orthon Metal Scraps. I think it's the one with the, I don't know, where
pretty
something
sure it's
has
the Orthon
to spawn.
Because you have to get a certain rate for a certain amount of time, and you mathematically can't do that.
Yeah, I know there's one that's in the known issues that can't be completed. So,
yeah.
But yeah, I like going in with a group way more than I do solo in there. Now, having said that, I do have one specific tip, and that is that small extractors 3 and 4 are close enough together that one person can guard them both. So if you're going to solo and you want a couple of small extractors, there you go.
Yep.
I put 2 cannons at number 3 and let it take care of itself. Yeah, 3 is on its own. You're on your own. Peace. I got
you kind of
want
to find a pathing that works for you is kind of the big thing. You might not have the most economical pathing. I actually, doing Makar's challenge, I ended up using someone else's pathing as opposed to mine to try and get a little bit better off. And I would say on average it was, although it wasn't my highest score, but it was kind of on average a little better. But yeah, you know, it's kind of figuring out what pathing you like, how many extractors do you like to upgrade to. Really, it's all about getting the large extractor. I would say, too, you don't have to defeat the red-named monster that's sitting on the extractor before the large extractor before you start it. You can start it before you kill that thing, so be aware of that, too.
Oh, one more specific tip. And you guys all know this, I'm sure, but upgrading the extractor completely repairs it.
Oh, yeah.
So just thought I'd throw that out.
That's absolutely true. Good point. I have another tip for that. Whenever an extractor is under attack and there's all this pressure on you, sort of, this to go and rescue it, and if mobs kill that extractor is more important than killing those mobs. Turn the extractor on before you address the aggro situation, because every second counts.
Yep. It's about keeping the extractors up and going rather than, you know, killing all the monsters. And if you do lose a small extractor, there's kind of two things with that. One is, I think each extractor, the small extractor at its base rate, is only giving you a quarter of a shard every second. It's not a huge, I think even upgraded, they're only giving you maybe one. They don't give you a lot, the small ones. You want to get to a large and get that going. As Lessa mentioned, killing the Archon is a really good way to jumpstart that, which is where I was
feeling
miserably.
I love how she begs you not
car.
To do it.
Yeah, it's kind of funny.
Makes me feel bad every time.
The other thing with that is they're not a huge return on, or they're not going to give you a lot of crystals for it, but just upgrading a small one to just turning it on from being off, it only costs a mechanical part. It doesn't cost any shards. So as long as you have parts to spare, it's free. So it's something to consider. Mm-hmm. So those are the House C challenge ones. I'll say maybe let's really quick. Is there any loot that you really, really like out of here? I know I really like the Stalker Ring. Almost every one of my martial classes has it. I think actually every one of my martial classes has it. I also like the Reconstruct Ring for my Warforged casters as well. Those are probably the two that I get the most out of here. The weapons are pretty decent too. I usually have some of the weapons. On most of my characters, particularly the Mournlord stuff for killing liches, is pretty good because you can get blunt weapons that are good and have Undead Bane.
These are a few of my favorite things. I completely agree with you. That is my number one on my list of favorite things is the Ring of the Stalker. At level 11, this becomes an amazing piece of gear. Then you're not going to want to take it off because when you roll a 20, heads go flying. I wish I could see the heads go flying. That would be very nice. Jerry, get on that. Right? Chop, chop.
Yeah.
It's not going to do itself.
Four graphics.
I also really enjoy the Cloak of the Flames that on most of my melee characters, I'll get a Ring and Stalker, I'll get a Cloak of the Flames, and I'll get Bracers of the Wind. Even though Cloak of the Flames, it's got caster stuff on it. Maybe you guys know about that caster stuff, but I really like the fire shield, I like the heightened awareness that it has, and I like the fire absorption that it has. Because if I can wear fire absorption on my cloak, that means I can wear something else on my body, like electric absorption or whatever. And now I'm just that much better in a fight.
I know that when I'm on Lemania, I am constantly being asked to make elemental great axes of fire. So folks must like that one.
Cool.
Yep.
And I also enjoy the Bracers of the Wind because you can buy this thing at level 3 and you've got permanent blur all the time. Who doesn't want permanent blur at level 3?
Right.
And then as you go up in level, you can upgrade it and it just gets better and better. And then the next thing you know, you've got blur, you've got an air guard. Every once in a while I'm fighting something, it just falls over because of the air guard thing that's on it. Pretty cool.
Jeff, do you have a favorite item in here?
I like the Mournload Maul for undead because I have a maul user. And as you point out, it's good for liches. I used to make Calomel stuff for dragons, but Thunderforged is so much better at that. I don't do that anymore. And I think everyone has already named all of the named items, so I don't think I need to call them out. They're already called out.
Yeah, one thing I'll throw a
quick shout
out
about
the boots.
Go ahead.
How much should we talk about
the Ring of the Master Artificer?
Well, I typed for you, but I want to mention the boots real quick. It's not a really great item. It's got some stuff that's nice on it, but for its level, I wouldn't say it's really fantastic at like level 20. But it does have immune to slippery surfaces. If that's something you don't have on another item, that can be something that's pretty decent. And I'm going to give another shout out to the Mournlord because it's probably one of the best sleeper weapon sets in the game. It requires the heroic ingredients, not the epic ingredients, just to get to tier 1. I don't usually go any higher than that, just because time versus benefit. But as a level 20 weapon, you can use it at all your epic levels. It's you can get them. They're generally all bludgeoning.
You're talking about the Warhammer?
Well, there's a Warhammer, there's a Light Mace, there's a Maul.
There's a longsword as well.
There's a longsword. I don't generally get the longsword. Usually what I'm using this for is I want it to be bludgeoning. It's got righteousness on it, so it's good, which means it hits liches, and it's got greater undead bane. So unless you have a triple positive maul, it's just a great golf bag weapon for killing undead, specifically liches. So
it's a great weapon, period. And I have this not only in the heroic levels, but I've also made it in the epic levels for my paladin. And I upgrade, and both times, this is my biggest advice about these challenge ingredients. Once I hit level 15, I upgrade these things to the highest tier that I can, because they only get better. And in the epic levels, you have two, not one, but two augment slots on them. So I have that hammer that you were just talking about, and it has Radiant Blast on it, and it has Brilliance on it, and it's plus six. And I have two. I have a red augment slot, and I have a colorless augment slot. It's so versatile. So it's, you're absolutely right. It's a great golf bag weapon for whenever, especially for whenever you're fighting undead. It's just wonderful. I would like to mention that if you take your item to the crafting, to the third tier in the heroic levels, that item is going to end up binding to character because you're crafting on it. Does that make sense? Okay.
The,
but if you don't like what you've crafted,
the same thing too.
Yeah, if you don't like what you've crafted, you can take it right to the coffee grinder inside the crafting hall, and you can disjunct it, and none of the original stuff comes off. Only the shard that you put on it comes off. So, and but you also have to be aware that if you're going to craft on those things, it raises the minimum level, which is, but that's okay, because you've earned your House Caneth favor, and now you can get a Masterful Craftsman shard, and you can bring the level back down, and you can use your item.
I just wanted to give another shout out to the Ring of the Master Artificer. If you are a Blade Forged, you really should look this one up. So,
indeed, I think it has an on hit reconstruct effect too. I think
that's right.
Which is like I think the only place in the game. There might be an item out of the Inkstrad Core that does it, but I don't think so.
Yeah.
Okay, so those House C, and we talked about those in detail. Let's talk about the Evening Star ones, and maybe we'll try and pick up the pace just a little bit. There's only three here. The first one we'll talk about is the Underdark Arena, which is kind of a fun one just from the standpoint that you just kill things. That's the whole plan here, is you kill things. You want to kill them as fast as you can, because the more stuff you kill, that's kind of what unlocks the later bosses, which you have to kill to get different stars. I would say that kind of the one, I mean, besides killing stuff as fast as you can, you know, start with the small stuff to get it out of the way as fast as you can, except for the bosses. You want to get rid of those generally. And I would say if you get the Wizard's Riddle early, you know, you have to go ring bells. And if you get the Wizard's Riddle kind of early on, what happens is there'll be chests in the other corners where you have to ring bells. And one of them is real, and the rest of them are mimics, and they're a real big pain in the butt. They make you really slow. They're not a lot of fun. And basically what happens here is as you are going to ring the bell, the mimic becomes activated, and then it kind of causes havoc. So if you know the bell, there's going to be a mimic near a bell that you're going to have to ring later, go get the mimic earlier rather than later. That's kind of my big tip here. I don't know if anyone has any other tips. This one's pretty simple, so.
Yeah.
Lots of fire resistance, and crowd control is your friend.
I would say that the last boss on Fight to the Finish comes with a whole lot of precesses. You might consider just having someone kite them around for a while, so everyone else can kill the boss, because they can be kind of a pain.
In general, as a tactic in DDO, when you have relatively small spaces with high mob density, you know, crowd control is your friend. So things like, say, you know, even Symbol of Death is a great way to damage everyone while you're kiting, blade barriers, and, you know, what have you, right? So it's fairly easy to get a lot of people through whatever CC you're casting, because, again, you may be able to manage aggro well, and you have a fairly limited space, so.
We'll talk about the ritual one next, which is somewhat similar in that you're in a smaller area and things are coming to you for the most part, but you have to actually guard something this time, which is really the main goal. This is kind of a funny one in that it's probably the only one where you can lose before time runs out, but still win. Because it's a 10-minute thing, and if you make it 7 minutes in, you win. That's the main goal. In the last 3 minutes, you have to guard something else, and if that gets destroyed, then it's over. But you still can win. It's kind of a weird mechanism.
It's almost like it came out and it had an instant death mechanism, and someone said, "You can't do that." Just say.
This one, there's going to be two bosses that you have to fight. One, the second one will come to you. The third one the first one you have to go and get. I like assigning people. There's basically a center area and three kind of spokes, two to the north and one to the south. I usually have assigned one of the three or one person to each one of those to just go and find the dude and bring him back. There's also ballistas that you have to repair. You have to find six parts, three per ballista. They have specific points that they can be in. So it's like they're going to be in one of six spots kind of thing, or three of six spots. Three of them are going to be close to the main center area, and three of them are going to be out along the spokes, which they can be hard to find sometimes, so just you might have to look for them. If you're really going for stars...
In general, I'd recommend...
Have the person that's going to go get the ballistas go to them right away, too.
I was just going to say, if you're soloing this one, you might want to not try for that objective. That one really is more of a group one, as far as I've found. Just because some of those are so far out there, but by the time you get there, you need to get back, and it just can be kind of rough. But
yeah, unlike the range. Canis challenges, range is great. Unlike the Canis challenges, the Evening Star challenges really are beneficial to have a group. Particularly like the Ritual and the Underdark Arena, part of your score is based on killing things, and you get more things to kill in a group. So that can be a really big benefit. Lessa or Jeff, do you have anything to say about the rituals?
No. Sorry. How uninteresting of me, huh?
There's less... I think the Evening Star ones
are a lot. I'm muting my microphone. Maybe I can talk. Sorry, I'm sitting here saying things and wondering why you're not answering me. It's because my microphone's muted. I apologize. This isn't my favorite one. You know that stupid assassin at the beginning that you talked about? Think you're brave, do you? And he's hiding in the woods somewhere. I can never find that guy! Where is he hiding? It drives me absolutely insane. It's not my favorite challenge, even though it has werewolves in it.
Actually,
that's
maybe
evil twin.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'd say in general, the Evening Star ones are a lot simpler than the House C ones. So there's the ritual, and again, I would mention with the ritual one, it's not as much about... I mean, if you want to get ingredients, you want to kill stuff, but this one's, again, not as much about killing stuff as it's about guarding something. Which is even more true of the last one, which is the Grove challenges. I think it's Druid's Grove, if I'm not mistaken. This one you have to... It's very similar to the Cobalt Island Extractors. You have to guard trees that generate life force. There's three that will generate that. Again, you want to get those things upgraded as quickly as possible so they're pumping out the good stuff as fast as possible. One of the two has... defense trees. I never really bother doing anything with those. Maybe I'll cast a resist on them. You can't cast resistance on the trees, by the way. Fire and electric is highly recommended.
Ooh, good thinking.
I think you can also cast blur on them as well. You cannot invis them anymore. You used to be able to invis them as well. And for certain reasons, those in the extractors are not invisible. You can't make them invisible anymore. But in this one, it's not about killing stuff. There are two objectives in each of them that are about killing a named thing. But if you want ingredients, you don't necessarily need to do that, although they're not too hard to kill with a party. But it's about keeping those trees going. Get them as much life force as you can. Upgrade them quick. Keep stuff off them. I find the casters are particularly troublesome since they drop firewalls on them, and that's no good.
Yeah, pretty much.
The Grove is my favorite of the Evening Star challenges because it's classic tower defense. Mm-hmm. So, clearly it inspired by and mimicking classic tower defense games. So I've managed to six-star solo both of them, and I think they're fun, good times. I like those. I have a really hard time getting a group together, though, for any of the Evening Star challenges. And
which is a shame, because they're great XP.
Well, they are good XP, but they're not useful ingredients-wise because of the random mechanism on how you get rewarded. So,
yeah, the weapons
don't know where to go with that.
Aren't the best. I like the cloaks out of these. The bear and wolf cloaks are pretty good. But yeah, the weapons. Now, if you want a thrower, these are some of the best throwers in the game because the spell touch ones have a chance to hit twice. And you can get some pretty decent effects on them. It might take you a few iterations to get one that you like. But if you just need a cheap thrower that's pretty decent, good place to start.
Yeah, I'm told by Saba Jade, who has several thrower builds, that if you get this random throwing weapon at level 24, then basically you're getting three things and then you're getting three hidden things. So basically you're getting six random things on this returner. That's pretty cool. I thought, wow, I want to roll a thrower. No, I don't. But seriously, I thought about it for like 2 seconds. There you go.
Throw's probably the
thing gear, that mithril cloak that you talked about, that cloak of the bear, I have that on my duck, on my level 27 permadeath duck. I took it, and it's an exercise in patience because you have to start at the lowest level. You have to start at level 15, and they want 600 of three different types of ingredients, and then to upgrade that, you have to take your old one, and then you have to add 600 of three more different types of ingredients at level 20, and then you have to do the same thing at level 24. I took this to level 24, and I stopped. I was like, that's it. I'm not doing this ever again. This was, I hate to say the G word, but it was kind of a grind, especially with those gold coins. They come out of one of the arenas.
Yeah, the arena ones are probably the hardest ones to farm for. Are definitely kind of the pinch point, as it were. But again, I'll say that, you know, you can get like the rituals at 15 minutes between the two of them with an XP pot. You'll easily clear 175,000 XP.
There's a guy on the forums who claims that if you do all six of the Evening Stars to six stars, it's 1,000,000 XP. I don't know if that's true, but holy smokes. I mean, that's 1/6 of your epic right there.
You're generally going to get at least 100,000. I mean, if you've got a voice and some kind of XP pot running, you're probably going to get about 100,000, 120,000 out of five of the six, and the other one is half that because it's half the time. It's only 5 minutes instead of 10. There's a lot of XP.
Right, I guess challenges in general award more XP the first time you run them than subsequent times. So I would recommend
the first time you get a star. The first time you get a star. So if you get two stars first time and then you get three stars the second time, you'll get more for that third star that run than you would in subsequent runs.
Yeah, good point. Okay, well, at the very least, I would recommend running all of the challenges at least once because you can suck up a lot of XP and it'll get you a ton of it. So,
especially the Evening Star ones, they're really good for XP. The House C ones aren't quite as good.
Yeah.
Plus, then you can figure out which one is your favorite by doing them.
Indeed.
And you can
it'll
say
be the opposite of mine.
Exactly. I'm so glad that there's someone who doesn't agree with. What is the best challenge and what is the worst challenge? I think that's awesome, Jeff. All right. My biggest advice for challenges is the plan to get those ingredients at the very lowest level that you can, because as you level up, the mobs level up with you and their attacks become more sophisticated. So I like to get in there at the lowest level that I can and get as many ingredients as I can. The thing I do is I go shopping, basically. I look at the challenge vendors, I figure out what I want, and I write down what ingredients I'm going to need for each item in my bio. That way I don't have to go back and reference anything. I can just look in my bio and see exactly what I need, do a little bit of quick math, and I put some music on, go solo 2-3 challenges, and that might be my gaming day for that afternoon. That's it. You don't have to do these things all at once. You can just kind of meter it out as you need it. I mean, really, it's a question of how badly do you want it. But if you're going to do it, commit to the item and do it. Take it as high as you possibly can go. Because you're already doing the challenges. You might as well get as much as you possibly can. Hopefully that didn't sound like a soda commercial just then, but
that's good advice.
That's my biggest advice. And I have a special note for free-to-play players. Log in and out in House Caneth, or in the Evening Star right there in the middle, in the square, the town square, whatever, right there where Elminster hangs out and doesn't do anything like he does whenever he pops into quests every once in a while. And go to the challenge token vendor once a day, either when you log in or when you log out. That way you have a little pile of challenge tokens, and if you don't have these different things unlocked, then whenever your friends say, hey, let's go do challenges, you don't have to say, oh, I can't do it, or oh, you have to buy me a guest pass, or whatever. You can just go do it. There you go.
Or another option.
I've got a tip, too.
Wait for the bonus days.
Well, that's what I was just going to say, right? it may be our least popular bonus, but there are people who very much look forward to it because it generally gives you an extra 50% of your challenge ingredients.
Well, the 50 is kind of a new thing, isn't it? It used to be more like 20 to 30, and then the last time it was 50.
Yeah, well, it may have something to do with me saying, hey, if we're going to do it and people don't so much, then at least we should give them a lot more of it. So,
my strategy with challenges is I kind of have an ongoing list of, I mean, it's shrunk drastically over the years, but I kind of have an ongoing list of, I know that this character eventually wants to have this for their challenges, and then it's like, 50% challenge weekend. I'm like, all right, buckle up, do some challenges, grab a beer, here we go. Gonna crank them out.
Incoming.
It's.
Oh, I have a question for Lessa.
Yes, sir.
Which of these challenges are hardest on permadeath? I mean, I would think arena would be just the bane to permadeath players.
No, that is our actually the Sitting Ducks, my high level permadeath group. That's our favorite one.
Do you run it at level or above level?
No, at level. because if you run it above level, then you're gonna get a penalty. Like, was it 10%, right?
It's,
if you run it,
it's cumulative, I think.
Over level? Yeah.
I think it's cumulative.
You don't want to run it over level. You want to run it at your level. And we try to kill the main guy, either the Drider or the dragon, every time. They think that's the funnest one. That's the one that I could talk them into doing the easiest. The Sitting Ducks do not like to repeat content. So getting them to do challenges for me was very challenging all by itself. one last piece of advice for people who plan to TR. Get your challenge ingredients at every level. This is something that my friend Saba Jade does. She'll go and she'll get a treasure hunter's spyglass from the Crystal Cove, and she'll get it at every level for her rogues, and then she just keeps it in the shared bank so that when whatever TR she's doing, she can just go and get the gear that she needs. So there you go. You can upgrade it for fewer ingredients, but you can always just buy another one at a higher level.
Actually, you raise a good point, which is kind of a bug, but not a bug. It's a design that I probably will get changed at some point.
Hey,
that is that if you're not that. I'm kind of getting to my point. If you are running, say, the challenges on epic levels, you will not typically get the ingredients that you need to make the base weapons. So that means that if you want to make a base weapon, you should typically get that while you're in the heroic levels.
That's for House C challenges. The Evening Star challenges use the same ingredient for 15 to 30. It doesn't matter what if you're doing epic or normal, but definitely the House C ones. I generally run them at level 20 with level 20 because, one, I don't TR a whole lot, and two, you know, Epic Destinies make it a little easier. You can really get going on some of those. So.
Yeah.
But if you're over level, you can still go and run in those. You can still do those heroic challenges.
Yes. Yeah.
Okay.
But you'll be penalized on your acquisition rate because of the penalty. So some people who are, you know, particularly sensitive to that tend to be a little upset by that change.
Well, and at a certain point, it's really not worth the time. It's better to just next time you reincarnate, hitting it all the way up, which is why I keep a running list so I know when I'm going to do that. All right, then. So there you go. There's a lot of tips and tricks for challenges, over an hour's worth. We're going to jump into game news and cruise through the rest of the show like we normally do. This is why I started putting the roundtable topic first, so we can hit that in its all its detail and gloss over the news and kind of cruise through it. So Lemania was updated this week. There is now a Warlock Half-Elf Dilettante feats and enhancements. I did not look at them. Jerry, do you happen to know offhand what they generally do?
Nope.
That's okay.
Sorry, I'd have to look it up.
There are also two new epic feats, which give you plus 2d6 Eldritch Blast die. So there's one for just a normal feat. There's also one that's one of the Destiny feats, if you have an Arcane Epic Destiny, which I assume means that it's Warlock is now going to start in the Arcane Sphere.
Correct. Well, no, actually.
They were talking about Primal, and then last I checked, it was kind of up in the air. There's also a new Warlock Past Life feat, the passive one being 3 MRR, which is a fairly comparable, I think, personally, that's a comparable bonus to what the other ones are in a different way. I like it. The active one, it gives you plus 3 to your spellcraft skill, and you can confuse an enemy 10 times per rest. And there appears to be a second one. Nope, that's the confusion part. It's just rewritten. There is now a skill-focused spellcraft, which has not been in the game. And
yay.
All classes now receive the Dismissed Charm feat at level 1. Yeehaw.
Yay.
There's also three new spells for Warlocks. Dark Discorporation, Ivard's Black Tentacles, and Silence Creature, which look to be available for all Warlocks and not a specific pact.
Correct.
There were some changes to Enlightened Spirits, which were fairly big changes and had a lot of discussion. They took out a couple of abilities, mostly relating to the healing. So there's no longer the Cure Moderate Wounds SLA or positive healing boost. What they replaced them with was I wrote down where they did not.
Temporary hit points.
Yeah, so basically temporary hit points. So Brilliance was at tier 4, replacing Cure Moderate Wounds. This got edited a few times, so my notes got edited a few times, and I think I kind of messed up where they were. But anyways, the new abilities are Brilliance. Your aura provides you and your nearby allies with a determination bonus to temporary hit points equal to your constitution score. If you're level 20 or higher, this effect is doubled. And Shining Through is getting a sacred bonus to temporary hit points equal to 15 times your constitution score that lasts for up to 10 minutes. And for 20 seconds, you gain a plus 25 sacred bonus to healing amplification. These will stack with other sources of temporary hit points. So there's those, and then I'm going to throw these in here really quick as well. They replaced the level 18 and 20 pieces for the core for this. The new 18 is a toggle. When enabled, you float above the ground, gain feather falling, and are immune to knockdown effects. This used to be in the capstone. When enabled, your Eldritch Blast gains 3d6 light damage. Your Eldritch R now affects enemies every 2 seconds. And the top one is plus 2 constitution, plus 2 charisma. While Celestial Spirit is enabled, you gain a plus 20% confidence bonus to hit points, full base attack bonus, plus 10 melee power, plus 10 range power, plus 10 universal spell power, and plus 20 light spell power. And there you go. My personal thoughts on this, with the temporary hit points, I don't have a problem with temporary hit points as a design choice. It's a hard sell for me, though, for that to be considered very survivable. And the reason I say that is temporary hit points, is that if that's your mechanism for recovering, it's not going to recover, and it's a losing battle. Temporary hit points are essentially short-term damage reduction. It's an ablative damage reduction source. Sooner or later, you will run out of hit points. There's no mechanism through these abilities to recover your hit points. I don't have a problem with that as a mechanic. I just don't think it's necessarily a desirable thing for survivability, because I generally don't find them to be that effective unless they're in really, really large amounts. And I don't think that's
like 15 times your constitution score.
That's like a short term.
This is
thing,
your constitution bonus.
Yeah, I know.
How often?
Well, okay, think about this. Let's say you have a 30 constitution. I have to do math to figure out what 15 times 30 is. 450, is that right?
Like that, yeah.
450? So 450 with a cooldown of 30 seconds, meaning every 31 seconds you can give yourself 450 temporary hit points on a 30 constitution score. Now let's say you have a 40 constitution score, et cetera, et cetera. Yes, it has a spell point cost of 8, but that's not particularly high. And so that is, you're right that it should be probably seen more as damage reduction rather than, say, reactionary healing. But as a significant form of damage reduction that you can pretty well keep going is certainly not insignificant.
It's not that it's insignificant. It's a philosophy thing for me. That's really what it comes down to. You know, every 30 seconds, part of this, every 30 seconds, it means I have to click this thing. One, that's kind of annoying. You know, the one that's with the aura, that's I think actually a better ability because I don't have to think about it. It's built-in survivability, right? If the ability is every 30 seconds I have to click this thing just to become more survivable, I mean, unless it's a healing thing, that's a little different. But if it's click this every once in a while to add damage reduction or stone, essentially a larger stone skin is what it is. And, you know, I am terrible at consumables. I am not very good at using stone skin. It's a little... I don't like the idea of having to make in order to make my character more survivable, I have to click this one specific button every 30 seconds.
I will also say that not only do they stack with other sources of temporary hit points, but they stack with each other because one is a determination bonus and one is a sacred bonus. So.
Does healing amplification affect temporary hit points too?
No, but they have said that they want that may change specifically for these. They want these at least to have some sort of effect with healing amplification. I don't know if that's going to happen, but it has been a point of conversation. They want to try to make those abilities as written scale with healing amp, but it's not for sure. It's kind of a tech thing.
I see your point about the survivability because they have no true heal anywhere. But having said that, the way it was originally going to be released, these were just going to be Radiant Servants with Eldritch Blast. I mean, you know, where's the class differentiation? Why bother? So I think from this point of view, giving everybody in your party 500 ablative hit points is way more valuable than just, you know, Radiant Servant again. But I don't know. For me, the biggest disappointment in this whole set of release notes is they still haven't fixed the mouse wheel bug. They need to fix the mouse wheel bug.
Right. I want to make it clear here. Like, I'm not saying that these are bad abilities. I'm not saying they shouldn't be what they are. All I'm saying is, if the pitch is, we're giving you these abilities to make you more survivable, I don't consider that very desirable abilities for being more survivable. Will it help? Yes. But it's not really what I'm looking for in terms of survivability. And the biggest reason for that is it doesn't recover you. It prevents you from taking damage. It doesn't heal me in any way, shape, or form. It's just ablative damage that can soak damage up. And that's great, and I don't have a problem with that from a design standpoint. I completely respect that as a design philosophy and design choice. I just reject the idea of it being a major feature of survivability. That's really where I'm coming from. So, and there's other ways that they can heal themselves. Like they can use heal scrolls. Yeah. So, it's not... I'm not saying this warlocks are ruined now. I'm just saying as a philosophy, when it comes to temporary hit points and stone skin, that are short-term ablative things. And unless you're giving me 500 hit points every 2 seconds, it's not going to make, in my opinion, it's not going to make my character very appreciably more survivable. Because every, you know, sure, you can get 450 hit points every 30 seconds, but, you know, I'm going to take 450 damage from Epic Elite mobs every 3 seconds, so I'm going to lose anyway. Sure. Which is my point,
It'll
right?
be situational. I mean, I could think of something like Mark of Death, right, where you've got to deal with that elemental blast. You know, this could be a pretty effective way to take care
That's
of that.
That's a fantastic use of that ability. Like I said, I'm not saying they're bad abilities.
Yeah.
I'm just saying you're going to lose. Temporary hit points do not... They mitigate it, but they do not prevent death. You know, you got to get hit points back to prevent death. And I think it's absolutely fine that Warlocks don't have a primary way to do that.
I think this just turned into a TDO debate.
Yeah, a little bit. All right, so let's talk... There was also some more updates on what they're thinking for epic magical damage. They kind of stepped back from the stuff that they had proposed. They're not outright abandoning it or committing to it. However, it's clear that those weren't widely popular. No-brainer changes they can simply put in. The discussion will continue, albeit at a slower rate, and since it's definitely not targeted for 26 anymore, the near future will be focusing more on update 26. Vargo kind of tried a little bit of an experiment, and he admitted that he maybe wasn't exactly supposed to do it in the weekend, or heading into the weekend, but he wanted to kind of have start a discussion, propose something, and see how players reacted to it, so when they came in on Monday morning, they had some information on it.
I don't know if I should say this.
You probably should.
Vargul showed up on Monday morning. He's like, "By the way, Jerry, I totally killed your forums this weekend. I'm sorry." And I was like, "What? You did what?" But it was all right. It was perfectly fine. Yeah.
It was a good. I appreciated the pitch, and it was a. I think it was a good starting point for discussion. I didn't really have any strong opinions one way or the other. I would be completely fine if you're listening, Vargul. I'd be completely fine with those changes. I recognize that some people maybe are not. It would certainly get a little more interesting stuff to epic leveling, which I know Jeff would be in support of.
Yay!
There was also a really interesting suggestion. Someone put in a quick suggestion too. It said maybe every epic level you pick maybe two or three. He proposed two of the following, and then it was a list of things like. A small amount of MRR, a small amount of PRR, or I think it was melee power, range power, caster level, like plus one to cast level, an amount of spell damage, and an amount of spell critical. So you could kind of mix and match some of the stuff in epic levels to give them a little more flavor and stuff. And there's some, you know, it was a good way to start some interesting ideas.
And just to back up for those who are saying, what's this change to epic magical damage? This is the one where we're moving it, or the proposal was to move it from the epic destinies into the levels, correct?
So it was, there were a couple
That's
things.
What you're talking about, yeah.
One thing was moving caster level to epic levels as opposed to them being tied to specific spheres. The idea being that it would be a benefit for anyone who was between levels 20 and 25 and was not running in the correct sphere. If you were a cleric running in the divine sphere and you were less than level 25, you'd lose a couple cash levels, or in a similar fashion for arcane, but everyone else would get more caster levels. And once you got to 25, you'd be at worst where you were anyways, and then you would actually go higher than that. There were also some feats that were going to add some damage, critical damage as well.
And just to be clear, one of the big motivators that Vargwheel and the other devs have is that they're trying to find a way to answer the suggestion that you be able to earn XP in one epic destiny while essentially being able to use a different one. You know, there are people who maybe have a very good capped out epic destiny that they want to use because of things like this epic magic damage, but yet they want to level up something else as well. So this would essentially, at least in that regard, in regard to sort of the epic magic damage, would allow you to sort of level up in whatever tree you want, and this would be out of sort of your main epic destiny that you've already maxed out. So it was a part of an overall kind of larger conversation about epic destiny leveling and that's going on.
I think casters in particular find that, at least my casters find that to be more challenging to run out of destiny, particularly the martial sphere. Let's see. Also, it was mentioned that Crystal Cove will probably come out sometime in July. we're just going to skip that. We talked about this before the show, and we kind of decided to skip it. Maybe we're going to skip it. Bonus days, 25% XP and plus 5 VIP XP through today. So if you haven't been taking advantage of that, get on it, and hopefully you can kind of get some nice little XP boost out of that. Store news, you can get 20% off of Epic Destiny's Tomes of Fate, Keys of Destiny, and Fast Travel through Thursday, I believe. And the freebie for the week is a long-lasting Bull's Might Potion times 5 with the code BUFF12. Let's see, community news. The 146th Chronicle, we got a shout-out for the second guild feud. Hope everyone enjoyed that. If you participated and submitted something in the second version, check your mail. You probably have prizes. Almost, I'd say probably 90% of people got something in the mail and got a goodie out of it. And some of those people need to respond to me so that we can get you your goodie. There's a choice involved and stuff. So if you did that, check your in-game mail. Check the unconfirmed box or whatever that is.
And just a heads up, I think for the item distribution that I need to do, you know, my part of it here, I think I'm probably going to get to that tomorrow. So you should get it by the end of the workday tomorrow.
Yeah.
I entered the feud using my wife's name, my wife's character name. And she looks at me the other day, she goes, "Who's Shamgar, and why is he sending me stuff?"
There you
I
go.
Told her, "Don't worry, it's some 12-year-old. He's probably, you know,
14.
Jeff and Anna creating sock accounts. Oh, wait a second. We weren't going to talk about that.
Let's see. If you're looking for Constitution, Deadlock has a post as well. See, some of the events. Round 7 of Makar DDO's 10-week challenge. Oh, it was Terminal Delirium and in the Demon's Den. That's what I'm going to be doing after we're done here. Terminal Delirium is tough, I'd say.
Yes, it is.
Yes, it is.
And I have a plan, and I'm going to execute it, if for no other reason than it's going to be hilarious to try it. It may or may not work. I'm going to give it a good solid shot. But I did manage to do Into the Demon's Den, which was actually surprisingly easy, but quite tedious, with the dragging the djinns to the same, or the Afridi to the same point. It took a little doing. I think I spent about half the time I was in there doing just that, and getting them down. Howards of Malkir hosted a Caught in the Web yesterday, and the Halfling Summer Games are going on this week. They did Chronoscope and Tempest Spine. The Guild, Nox Aegeus, is a small, new player-friendly guild on Wayfinder looking for new people to play with, so you can check them out. The comment for the week, where does your character sleep? Sleep is for the weak. I am Warforged. There is no such thing as sleep. All right, do you guys have a place where your character sleeps?
Rusty Nail.
Yeah, I tried to come up with something funny, but the best I could do was Rusty Nail, too. Real creativity lapse this week. Sorry.
Why the Rusty Nail?
Because that's my tavern. That's the place I've logged out of the game.
So you walk in there and you say, "I own this bar. You want a drink?"
Yeah. You know, there's that little corner in the back, which no one ever goes to. And I just usually park down there, and then I'll hit sleep,
poker
and then I'll
log
out. Mm-hmm. Yeah,
cool.
So,
I'm going to guess that Lessa sleeps behind the rock.
And how's Caneth? Absolutely. If there's a rock in there, yes. Absolutely.
Let's see. Fansite news. DidoCast got a shout-out for our debates on Warlocks last week, which admittedly the Warlock portion of that was a little lackluster, but some of the other ones got a lot more debatey. The Damsels of DDO were in Madness. Was it Reign of Madness? It was a fun episode as well. DDO players talked Warlocks and more in episode 35, and their 36th episode is also out as well. There's kind of a really awkward thing with the DDO players now and the Chronicle, because the players record on Monday, the Chronicle comes out Tuesday, and the players usually publish their episode on Wednesday. So it's kind of a weird time warp thing with them right now. The Voodoo Spies explained how to do a puzzle in the Vault of Night Part 4. That was a nice, clear video on that. I made fun of him a little bit for his symbol choices, but they were clear and good. DDO Gamer, Jeff here, had a nice gif for the Elder's Blast. The Order of Cicletica looked at glass cannons. Enrique was looking at the usefulness of cannon crafting, and Full Moon Fury had 215 progress report. I don't know why that name is hard to say altogether. But there you go. Fridays at 4 also looked at the Soul Eater. This was the one before last one. Another weird time loop thing going on here. See. Some other stuff I wanted to mention. Ginger Spice had a guide to spell point regeneration items. So if you find your casters are lacking in spell points, we'll link to that in the show notes. Enrique, of course, had the usefulness of Kind of Crafting, which we'll give you a link to. Players News had the 36th episode. There was an 86th episode of Cocktail Hour. That was a lot of fun and an entertaining episode. Jeff declared it perhaps their best ever.
Yeah, because we really gushed good. All over him.
That was the that was the greatest podcast moment in the history of podcasts ever. Such discerning, wise folk you are. I had no idea. I thought you were just funny people making double entendre jokes.
That's right. And now I'm asking the community, if you don't read Jeff's blog, you need to ask yourself why. And you need to go read it. Because I really do enjoy it. I don't read very many blogs, I will admit. But when I read yours, I can hear you talking in my head and explaining things to me. And it's always, I feel like after you write about something, I get it.
All I know is that when I was a teenager, the newspapers used to come with these little TV sections to let you know what programming was on during the week. And ever since you started podcasting, Lisa, between, you know, Cocktail Hour and the Dance of the Video, I don't need a TV guide.
You are the one to tell me what I need to watch.
Yeah.
That's right.
It's like, well, if they like it, then it must be good. So here's what I should watch. So,
great minds.
Yeah.
There you go.
And I don't think they do that anymore, do they? Yeah.
They do. My roommate inserts. Actually works for a company that does some of that stuff for a mobile app.
Okay.
Believe it or not.
Nice.
Fun fact. Well, it's probably going to be going for a while. They'll probably keep doing it. DitoCast News. So Guild Feud 2 was out. I put a post on the forums so you can check out the what the results were and how well you did and all that stuff. And I should make a note to... link to that in the show notes because I don't think I did that last week. The other thing, there will be another contest coming out sometime this week. I was going to release it last week, and it got bogged down a little bit into determining prizes. No, I'm not trying to put you on the spot here. So I'm still trying to figure out what that's going to look like. If worst comes to worst, probably by Tuesday I will release the contest and add the prizes in later. But there will be prizes. Trying to make sure that they're good and meaningful because it should be a lot of fun. I've shown a few select people the contest and they were really excited about it. So I'm pretty excited about having it happen. I was just kind of waiting to figure out what the prizes were and release it all at once. But that may not happen. But it is coming. It will be out this week for sure. So you can at least get started on it. And there will be. Some sort of prizes, and hopefully they will be prizes that people will be very interested in getting, and hopefully there will be a lot of participation, and it will be a lot of fun. There we go.
I need to get back to you. I actually talked to Tolero on Friday. I haven't written you back yet.
It's okay. It wasn't a huge deal. I think I can probably at least say that Turbine will be providing some of the prizes. DitoCast will be providing some of the prizes based on the small kiddie pool that I have of donations or gifts. I've been told I'm not supposed to say donations, so we'll say gifts that people have been generous to give us on the show, so I'm going to be giving some stuff out there. Should be a lot of fun. I've heard really good feedback from the people that I showed it to. They were really excited to get started on. There's also going to be... I'm going to encourage side betting as well. There should be some fun opportunities for that. And it should be easily accessible for a large number of people. So you will not... It may be easier for some of the higher end game folks, but there will certainly be plenty of ways to earn enough points to get prizes without having to be end game, really high end game, which I saw a lot of people commenting on with the Makara DDoS thing, which is a fair point. It is a challenge, his challenge. He does not mince words with the word challenge in that thing. But there you go. Lightning Post. Penumbra wrote in that hirelings are good for the game. This is in reference to what we're talking about with hirelings and should they be in raids. We had that as a debate last week. Not everyone has hours to master a game. Casual players need more choice. Tell you what, stop adding traps unnecessarily. Stop creating massive hit point mobs and reward pugs. Then yes, get rid of hirelings. I don't know that there's really unnecessary traps. Traps add a lot of flavor. Although I would not necessarily disagree with, there are certainly massive hit point mobs, and rewarding pugs sounds like a great plan. And there has been rumors of this, but nothing concrete.
Odds are we're going to do something. As to when and what it is, I don't know. But we've certainly been talking about it internally for long enough now that something's going to happen.
Even externally, I mean, it's been a topic on the forums. A couple of the devs have chimed in that it's something they are looking at and they're discussing. But I do want to make it clear, too, like, no one was, I don't remember anyone saying we need to completely axe hirelings. It was just a question of should hirelings be allowed in raids? And there's some good points on that as well. The survey question.
The answer is no.
Yeah.
Yes.
Survey question for the week, I'm gonna try and limit this to like your top thing or maybe a quick thought. We're not gonna try and get too far into this, but Lavlove from Galanda asked, "What is the best way to ask a Zerger to slow down?"
I think you just ask them nicely and explain why. I mean, that's communication is not hard.
It depends. If it's like a friend of yours or maybe in a pickup group and or a LFM group or whatever and you specifically ask for no zerging, you know, then you might want to say something like, hey, this group specifically said in our LFM that we're not looking for zerging. You know, hey, if you want to zerg, that's cool, but maybe you should find a group that's more in line, you know, with that goal. But in general, I would say you don't ask a zerger to slow down. If ultimately someone is zerging, that's their choice. And if you are more, deliberate player? What's the right word for it? Non-zerging. Then maybe you two aren't compatible for general questing.
This relationship just isn't working, Gary.
Yeah, exactly right. So ultimately, play the way you want. Let them play the way they want. But I think specifically, if you say no zerging in your LFM, and you have someone join, and you're in the middle of a quest, and next thing you know, they're tearing down the hallway or something like that. You know, it would probably be to put it into a tell first off. You know, hey, I'm the party leader. We are specifically looking for a non-zerging. Would you be willing to tone it down? And then if they continue to do it, maybe sending another tell. Something like, you know, we appreciate, you know, it's cool if you want a Zerg, but maybe you should find a group that's more compatible.
I speak Jerry. He just said, respect my authority.
Exactly.
That's it. You can always send them to a different quest, you know, while you're going to do something else. Yeah. Because if you're going to solo, just go solo. Why'd you join my group in the first place?
Yeah.
Or you could just let them die, because a lot of times you'll see that people who are Zerging carelessly, not Zerging smartly, they'll die. Just pick up their stone, and then they won't be able to get ahead of the group until you get to the next shrine. It's all good. It's fine.
Those are options. My quick advice would be upfront communication is always the best, which means putting it in your LFM. It doesn't always work. I'll say that I was in a Shroud group, and someone did ask me to slow down, and they did it very well. I will say they did it very well. My only problem with it was... their LFM said Shroud fast. So I was going fast. So apparently they're, you know, I'm just going to say.
Everything's relative.
If you're going to put fast in your LFM, I was like, okay, but I'm just saying, you said fast. So when I went into the portal for part two before anyone else did, you said fast. I wasn't expecting. You got all really pissed at me. Or first, like, darn. His initial comment was fine. I was like, I kind of sent him back a question mark, and then he got a little upset. But as if I remember correctly, but I was like, you said fast.
Anyway,
but yeah.
The best thing to say to get a Zerger to slow down is just go into voice chat and say, "Whoa, is that person naked?"
Yeah.
Then they'll come back to the group. So
maybe. Let's see. Let's close
That's
the show.
Brilliant,
up.
Jerry.
Yeah.
Yeah. Let's close the show out. Lesa, why don't you start off with our what's going on with the damsels and cocktail hour, and give us some plugs here.
Wow, let's see. Yeah, I'm all over the place. I'm actually I do two different podcasts. I'm with the Damsels of DDO, damselsofddo.com, and I've been with Samus doing the DDO Cocktail Hour for several years now. We're on our 86th or 87th episode. You can catch that at ddococktailhour.com. The very best way, really, to figure out what I'm casting or twitching is to follow me on Twitter, and I'm at Lessa, L-E-S-S-A-H, at twitter.com. There you go.
Excellent. Jerry, do you want to plug the Twitch streams, and particularly your Twitch streams or anything?
Yeah, sure. Let me plug just a couple of things. First off, we're targeting tomorrow being Monday as of the time we're recording this, so Monday the 15th for a perhaps final Lemania update for the Warlock. So it's going to... We may still have a little development work afterwards, but it's the last planned Lemania update. So you can expect that on Monday, and perhaps update 26 not too long after that. So stay tuned for more information on that, but we are could even be out by next weekend, but we'll see what happens. And then otherwise, you know, we do have previews that you can find on our YouTube page. In particular, is a good place to watch those previews. You can find out about the Warlock and the Soul Leader tree. We're going to be doing a couple interviews here this week, so I know we've got an interview lined up with DDO Players News and a couple other things. So you'll see some links out there. Otherwise, just follow us on Twitter. It's DDO Unlimited. Facebook, DDO Unlimited. YouTube, Dungeons and Dragons. One word, no ampersand. Twitch.tv/DDOstream. You can find our entire schedule of events that way. Otherwise, DDO.com for just about anything else DDO related.
Just a quick note, too. If you're not following DDO Unlimited on Twitter, they give away like 5,000 turbine points on Tuesdays. Like, it's 10 500 yes. point codes, but they give away a bunch of point codes every week, so there you go. Jeff, what you got going on DDO Gamer?
Well, actually, my post this week is about how there are so many things going on with DDO right now. There's, I don't know, 5 podcasts I found, and still a dozen or more active blogs, and there's people doing videos, so I tried to put together a list, and it's a pretty long list. It's on my site right now. The main thing I learned, though, is that Lessa is my hero, and DDO Cocktail Hour 86 is really like the best thing that has ever happened to podcasting.
Finally!
If you haven't heard it yet, get over there and listen to it right now. That's episode 86, DDO Cocktail Hour.
Oh my God.
I guess, Lessa, that Jeff really liked the Samus Shamgar.
I guess
Lessa
he
threesome.
Really likes. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Really quick before I close up the rest of the show.
It was a good show.
Skunk City mentioned in response to the best way to add a Zerger to slow down in the chat, to bribe them with ham, which is a good tactic as well. So thanks for listening to the show. Thanks especially to the folks in the chat room. And thanks for Lessa, Jeff, and Jerry for spending some time with me today. It was a great show. And I hope you guys find that really helpful if you're looking for some tips on running challenges. Good luck with that. If you have other tips you'd like to share, please feel free to comment. Leave other folks some tips and add in your tips and tricks as well. I should probably also mention, too, that there is in the Makara DDO's series of Splat episodes I've been doing, there is one of me running Kobold Island. It's not the best run in the world, but it can give you an idea of how to run it. At least it's not narrated or anything, but you can check that out. Thanks also to the other contributors for DDO Cast. We've got a great group of folks that are helping out with that. And thanks to Turbine for making DDO, and thanks to Wizards, and to I'll say also to the Turbine employees listen to DDO Cocktail at her last week. I still love you guys. just had to get a few things off my chest a little bit. And also thanks to CyberGears for hosting the podcast. You can hit us up at ddocast.com for show notes, our calendar, previous show stuff. If you'd like to be part of the show, or just say hi, you can email us at ddocast@gmail.com. You can also leave a comment anywhere that will let you do so. I generally am, I try to stay as much on top of that as I can. You can also follow us on social media and follow us for latest cast updates there as well. At ddocast on Twitter is probably the best one you can choose. The closing tip for the week comes from AskGar on Kyber. He says, don't force yourself to always run elite. The game can be more fun if you play on an easier difficulty, which is, you know, a pretty good point. You don't have to always run Elite, and it's definitely sometimes a little easier. So with that, until next time, may all your attack rolls be crits, all your chests level appropriate, have fun, and don't forget to check out the awesome DDO community that Jeff pointed out as well. There's a lot of people doing a lot of fun stuff. Have a good weekend.